stylophones. They're impractical. They're annoying to play. They can't do chords. But they're so cool. I really, really want one. But there's a problem. I'm really cheap and I don't want to pay for one. So why buy one that works when I can spend more money making my own worse one? This way, it's a project. So here's what I want to do, and bear with me here, because this is basically just a silly thought I had one day that I've naturally taken way too seriously. So in the song Everyone's a Winner Baby by Hot Chocolate, there's this guitar riff. And I thought I should play that this album. That's it. That's the whole idea. I spent weeks of my life on this. I don't even know how to play a piano. This isn't even the right instrument. It's just a guitar riff. Since I just can't shake this idea, let's get started. Hi there. I figured I'd just take 5 seconds to quickly explain what a stylo, what's it is. It's like a little piano thing that you play with a stylus. That concludes our explanation. Now back to your regularly scheduled book.
Started.
So normally I would just half-ass this and plop an Arduino on a breadboard and then complain how it barely works. But in this case, I need to create the keyboard itself, which usually consists of a series of smooth conductive metal pads, not normally found on a breadboard. So I guess I'm gonna need to make a custom PCB for the keyboard. And if I'm doing that anyways, then why am I buying a functional Arduino that's assembled in a factory? Why buy one that works when I can spend more money making my own worse one? So yeah, if I'm gonna be making my own custom PCB anyways, I may as well just make the whole thing one PCB. That way, if I make one mistake, nothing works. However, some of the more pedantic of you might have spotted something here. It's not analog, which is not good for sound for some reason. And I actually have quite a good explanation for this choice. Analog schmanalog. Schmatic time. Alrighty, so let's take a look at this schematic, shall we? So most of this is just yoink from the open source Arduino R3 schematics, but I made a few special alterations of my own. So let's take a look. At the heart of this circuit, we have the brain. The absolutely legendary ATmega328P. This antiquated 14-year-old chip, based on a 30-year-old architecture, remains the pinnacle of microchip technology to this day. Oh, okay, so it might not look like much, but this is kind of like the Toyota Hilux of computer chips. It just works. Every time. All the time. Boasting a mind-boggling 20 megahertz clock speed, 32 kilobytes flash, 2 kilobytes RAM, and approximately 100 milliwatts maximum power draw. Here's some graphs comparing it to the Ryzen 7 3700X. Moving on, what does every digital circuit need? That's right, a lump of quartz. So it turns out if you zap quartz with electricity, it'll vibrate. Really, really consistently. And that's how clocks work. Weird. It's just weird. I don't have anything else to say about that. It's just strange. It's kind of odd. It feels like who's sitting there in their lab just f***ing zapping quartz, you know? And like, just zapping like, oh yeah, no, lithium, that doesn't do it. Oh, boron, that doesn't do it. Quartz. We also have power circuitry, both 5 volts and 3.3 volts. And unlike a regular Arduino, there is no USB communication chip. This has to be programmed via an FTDI cable. Basically just a little cable that takes USB from the computer and turns it into Arduino speak serial stuff. So now to the exciting stuff, the keyboards. That's right, there are actually three distinct keyboards here. I will explain why in a minute. Basically, what I decided to do is make a potentiometer. If you don't know what a potentiometer is, it meters potential. Electrical potential. It's a knob. Essentially, it's a resistive strip with power on one end and ground on the other. Here at the one end, the power is, let's say, 5 volts. And at the other end, it is 0 volts, ground. Because the voltage drops gradually over the resistive strip, if you use something to measure the voltage at some point in the middle, let's say this point, it will change the voltage as you move it up and down the strip. And that's how electrical dials, knobs, triggers, joysticks, and sliders work. So I took that, but I replaced the strip with 12 resistors and put metal pads in between, arranged the pads like a keyboard, and when you touch each key, you get a different voltage reading. That does not explain why I have multiple keyboards. Well, it does. Sorta. You see, I was afraid that maybe the data I received from just sliding a metal rod across a plate might not be super clean. So I wanted each key to have a range of acceptable values if the voltage wibbled or wobbled. This meant that I needed to decrease the number of keys for each bank. As I also wanted to have three octaves, an upgrade from the original Stylophone's 1.5, one bank of 12 keys per octave made sense. Now this introduces the new problem of knowing what bank our probe is probing, and to fix this, I've actually wired the power from each bank to a digital pin, not a dedicated power pin. And this way I can cycle them so that only one bank is on at a time. This might seem silly, but it will do it thousands of times per second, so it really shouldn't be noticeable. Alright, so now that you know what it all does, let me show you what I've made. Everything fits on this board, which is nice and pretty compact. We've got our I.O. up here, we've got our keys down here, and we've got our glorious 80 mega in the middle. The middle's over there, by the way. And a USB Type-B precariously dangling off the edge. You might notice that all the components here are through-hole components. If you don't know what that means they go through a hole. And that is because I've assembled SMD components by hand before, and I'm interested in enjoying my life. I also silkscreened the bill of materials on the back, because I need to idiot-proof this for the moron who will be assembling this. So, what are you waiting for? Oh, and because I'm a mechanical engineer by training, I filleted all the traces for better structural integrity and to reduce electrical stress concentrations. And here it is, a PCB I made all by myself with a little bit of help from a factory in China. So I actually wanted white PCBs, but green ones were cheap. So here are the green ones. So it looks really nice now, but I'm probably going to f*** this up during assembly. But by the magic of ordering 30 of them, it should be fine. Seriously though, it was really expensive for 5, and it was only like twice the price for 6 times that many PCBs. So if you want one, let me know. So now it's time to leave a PCB under my pillow for the DigiKey Fairy. By the way, if you're interested, I'll leave a shopping list in the video description. Please excuse my bad soldering, by the way. I bought this new soldering iron for about 15 euros, and it's just too big and the wrong wattage for this sort of thing. Also, it looks like it might benefit from a little blue pill. Turns out that maybe you do get what you pay for. Alright, so it's done and ready, but there's a few steps we need to do before we can play it. Firstly, we need to burn the bootloader. So to do this, you need to find another Arduino and then connect them both like this. Upload the burn bootloader code to your Arduino, and then click burn bootloader on the IDE. And secondly, we need to upload our code. As I mentioned earlier, there is no USB communication on this board. So we'll need to upload the code using an FTDI cable. There are other methods like using another Arduino, similar to how you would burn the bootloader, but I like this one. So, to do this, I'm connecting my FTDI cable to the Arduino via these pins. I've also reversed TX and RX so that the transmitting data from the FTDI cable comes into the receiving pin on the Arduino, and vice versa. Now we have our cable hooked directly up to the 80 mega via serial, and this cable will act as our USB communications chip. Basically, this will allow me to connect the USB comms only when I need it, and then also save some money in the process. Now I should be able to just program it like any other Arduino, except for the fact that my FTDI cable does not have the reset capabilities to put the Arduino into programming mode. But do not despair! If you have a more limited cable, like I do, just press and hold down the reset button on your Arduino. Then click upload on the computer. When you see some orange text in the console, release the reset button. And it should just work! If it doesn't work, try sacrificing a goat or something. So this LED doesn't work. That's not a great omen. Turns out I accidentally ordered a common anode RGB LED instead of a common cathode one. So if you're making one of these for yourself, don't do that. Also, I noticed the speaker port is wired wrong. Whoops. I might have accidentally hooked it up to one of the keyboard power pins. So that isn't really gonna work. Luckily for me, we've got these I.O. pins here, so we can easily select another digital pin for the speaker. Speaking of the speaker speaks. And I guess I'm a speaker speaking about the speaker speaking. It's a piezo, so it doesn't sound great, but it works, although it sounds weird. Turns out I had programmed the notes in backwards. and some of them were just missing. I'm not even sure how it worked properly with more keys than it had notes. But, oh well, so I fixed it now, and this is how it sounds. Admittedly, it's a little tinny, but luckily for me, Past Noah has my back. A few years ago, my headphones broke, and being the logical and sensible person I am, I dismantled them and stashed away the drivers like a squirrel hoarding nuts. Completely normal behavior, I know. Of course, when I moved, the box of junk came with me, just in case. And, well, now I have proper speakers for my project. That sounds so much better. Also, I just want to address what you may or may not be thinking already. Yes, the stylus is a branded swag screwdriver, but in my defense, it was only €2.75 on DigiKey. And it makes an adequate stylus. While I would have liked to get a custom CNC stylus, the theme of this video is cheap. So I guess all that's left to do now is show off my musical talent. Would now be a good time to mention that I don't know how to play the piano? I'm not really sure how to conclude this. I made something that works this time. I guess if you want one, I'll put links in the description to everything you might need. Lists, code, files, etc. As for the price, the Stylophone S1 can be had for about €30. On this project, I spent around €70 plus tax and shipping. However, I do want to mention that I got parts for 3 Stylophones as well as 30 PCBs. If you want to do this for yourself, your costs, of course, probably will vary. I also do want to mention the increased value you get from a Styloduino. Not only is it an instrument with twice the range of the regular Stylophone S1, but it is also a fully functional Arduino that can be modded and adapted however you like. And if you did want just a bare-bones instrument, you can, of course, lower the cost by removing the RGB LED, which doesn't work anyways, I/O pins, 3.3-volt bus, and other related components. So yeah, if it's a project that looks interesting to you, maybe give it a shot. And if you're interested in giving it a try but want to buy just one PCB, maybe let me know below, and if there's enough interest, I might consider selling off some of the extra PCBs I have. Anyways, this has gotten a little serious, so I'm going to end it here. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.